There's a bright flash of blinding light. Cities around the world are consumed by the mushroom clouds created by nuclear bombs. Shockwaves sweep across the land, leveling everything in their paths. This is not just an isolated incident. Every nuke on the entire planet has just exploded. The next few minutes will be filled with destruction, devastation, and death. The scariest part of all is what comes after the initial blasts will be worse than the detonations themselves. The moment before all nukes on Earth explode. There are approximately 3,750 active nuclear warheads in the world today. However, humans have close to 13,800 nukes at their disposal, as this number also includes the number of nukes in reserve as well. For this doomsday scenario, all of them will go off at the same time. These devices are currently under the protection of a handful of governments around the world, but the United States and Russia control the vast majority of them, at around 90% of the total. There are several different types of nuclear bombs, but they can be broken down into two main categories: fission bombs and fusion bombs, milliseconds before all nukes on Earth explode. For some unknown reason, every nuke is launched or detonated across the planet at the same time. Maybe world leaders decide upon mutually assured destruction to make sure if they can't rule the world, no one can. Or perhaps some unknown force beyond our understanding passes through our planet and reacts negatively with our nuclear stockpiles, causing every nuke to explode at once. Earth might just be one giant alien science experiment, and they've realized that humans are causing far too much trouble, therefore need to be removed from the equation. They decide the best way to do this is to use their superior technology to cause every nuke to go off at once. The aliens figure there is sort of a poetic justice to it all, as this doomsday scenario will end humanity using weapons that were created by human hands and should never have been stockpiled in the first place. Regardless of the reason, the result of every nuke on Earth exploding at once will have terrible consequences. The two main types of nuclear bombs detonate in slightly different ways, but both only take less than a second to explode. Fission bombs, or atomic bombs, like those dropped on Nagasaki and Hiroshima during World War II, create nuclear explosions by splitting the nuclei of atoms 600 billionths of a second before all nukes on Earth explode. An explosive fires within all the warheads that use fission reactions to generate a nuclear explosion. It propels a bullet of uranium-235 down a narrow chamber toward a sphere of uranium-235 that surrounds a neutron generator. The uranium bullet strikes the sphere, penetrates it, and continues into the neutron generator. This causes uranium atoms to split and creates a fission reaction. Enormous amounts of energy are released as the nuclei of atoms break apart. As more and more reactions occur, the bomb detonates. There is a massive amount of energy released as millions of nuclei are split, ejecting neutrons from their core. Radiation envelops the surrounding area, temperatures skyrocket. At that same moment that the fission bombs begin their detonation process, fusion bombs do the same. These types of nuclear devices are known as thermonuclear or hydrogen bombs and take a few milliseconds longer to detonate than their cousins that only use fission to achieve a nuclear explosion. This is because the process of creating a fusion reaction is a little more complicated. The main difference is that instead of solely splitting the nuclei of atoms, the fusion bombs also fuse nuclei together. This generates even greater energy and causes exponentially more destruction. Thermonuclear bombs use high-energy radiation known as X-rays to initiate a fusion reaction. There are two main steps in the process. First, the bombs need to generate fission reactions to create enough energy to allow for fusion to begin. When the bomb's activated, this initial fission reaction yields enough heat and pressure within the bomb's casing to cause nuclei to fuse together. The casing is made of uranium-238 along with lithium deuteride, which acts as a fuel source for the fusion reaction. This casing surrounds a hollow rod of plutonium-239. The plutonium sits at the center of the hydrogen bomb and is the key to generating a fusion reaction. When the fission reaction around the casing commences, it bombards the uranium-238 with X-rays. This increases the heat within the cylinder to extreme levels. The casing of uranium-238 becomes superheated, but protects the fuel and plutonium from becoming damaged. Massive amounts of pressure and energy cause the casing to expand and burn away while simultaneously exerting inward pressure against the lithium deuteride fuel. This pressure compresses the lithium deuteride at around 30 times its original size. The pressure is then exerted onto the plutonium rod, which sends shockwaves through its atoms and initiates a second fission reaction. This causes the plutonium to give off more heat and radiation, leading to the release of neutrons from the nuclei of the atoms. These free neutrons enter the lithium deuteride and force a reaction that forms tritium. Now the fuel within the bomb is made up of tritium deuterium and deuterium deuterium. These two molecules fuse together as a result of the enormous heat and pressure being released by the fission reactions all around them. This produces even more heat, radiation, and free neutrons. A chain reaction occurs as the neutrons from the fusion reaction cause the uranium-238 that remains from the initial fission reaction to produce even more radiation and heat. This process continues and the bomb detonates, generating an explosion thousands of times larger than the atomic bombs that use only fission. The blast is equivalent to approximately 10,000 kilotons of TNT going off all at once, 1 second after all nukes on Earth explode. The location of each detonation across the planet is different. If all nukes are launched because nations are at war with one another, the devastation will likely be directed at major cities. If the bombs detonate in their silos and aboard vessels that are carrying them, the destruction will be contained to military installations. The location of any secret bases that are hiding nukes will quickly become apparent, as they're consumed by nuclear blasts. It doesn't actually matter why or how the nukes go off, as the consequences of such a scenario will be the same. Wherever a nuke detonates, there will be a bright flash of light. The area around the bomb will become superheated as a fireball consumes everything within 1,600 feet. Anyone and everything in the vicinity of the bomb will be instantly vaporized. The temperatures within the blast radius will reach up to 150 million degrees Fahrenheit, so there will be nothing to recover after the explosion subsides. If the bomb is detonated at ground level, it will leave a crater at around 1,378 feet across and 300 feet deep. Anyone who's looking in the direction of one of the nuclear blasts will go blind. The image of a mushroom cloud will become burned into their retinas. This haunting vision will likely be the last thing they ever see, 10 seconds after all nukes on Earth explode. Anyone within 6.5 square miles from the epicenter of the blast will soon be in big trouble. The explosion causes a drastic change in air pressure, which creates a shockwave of superheated air. It sweeps across the landscape, decimating any cars, buildings, and people in its way. The speed and force of the shockwave does not just knock things over, but completely tears them apart. You cannot outrun it. There's no chance of survival if you're within its reach. People who are further away still suffer from third-degree burns, as the heated air and intense radiation expand outward from the blast site. Anyone within 5 to 10 miles who is not killed by the shockwave will instantly feel their skin start to burn and blister. Their cells begin to denature and die. The pain is unfathomable as they scream and writhe on the ground, praying for death to take them so it can all be over. Depending on how close to the blast someone is and how much radiation their body absorbs, the symptoms of radiation sickness might start to develop within just a few minutes. They'll begin to vomit, sweat, and lose control of their bowels. Eventually, the symptoms become so bad that they pass away from radiation poisoning. 5 minutes after all nukes on Earth explode, the remnants of mushroom clouds fill the sky. They no longer have their distinctive shape, but the smoke and debris can be seen floating in the wind. Anyone who survived the initial blasts looks around in horror as the sky begins to become darker. People who are lucky enough to be nowhere near the blasts likely don't have any idea what's going on. There will be small indications that something is wrong, as the amount of electromagnetic radiation released by each nuke will wipe out electronics across the globe. The ones that are not affected will be unable to pick up any signals, as major cities have been wiped out in the initial wave of destruction. Satellites are no longer receiving signals, and radio towers are out of commission. Entire electrical grids go down, and power stations begin to fail. If any of the nukes go rogue and detonate in space, the EMPs will knock out any satellites within the vicinity. The fallout from the blasts falls to Earth, coating large areas with radiation. In all, around 23 cubic miles of land have been destroyed in the explosions around the planet. The matter that makes up Earth was converted into heat and energy that now begins to heat up the planet, but this heating period will be brief. On the horizon is the frozen hell that will become known as nuclear winter. 15 minutes after all nukes on Earth explode, debris starts to settle as fires rage across the planet. There are wildfires consuming forests, buildings, and anything else that's flammable near the nuclear blasts. Fire departments are a thing of the past, as their resources have been destroyed and their personnel have been killed. There are no longer any police officers or paramedics to help people who survived the nuclear detonations. It's every man for themselves, as the only thing anyone can focus on is getting as far away from the searing heat and deadly radiation as possible. Around 90,000 square miles of buildings and infrastructure have been destroyed, which is equivalent to around 300 cities the size of New York. Everyone's now desperately trying to evacuate to more rural parts of the planet. There's a great exodus out of the cities, where chaos and panic break out. People are trampled under the feet of the masses. No matter what anyone does, it will not matter in the long run. The future holds nothing but further pain and suffering. Radiation-filled dust and particles are carried across the planet by winds and storms. Poisonous rains fall from the sky. People who did not receive a lethal dose of radiation from the initial blasts will soon inhale contaminated particles. Their DNA will begin to mutate, and vital organs will begin to fail. Around 110,000 square miles of planet Earth are no longer safe to live on due to nuclear fallout, and this is just the beginning. The collective radiation generated from the detonation of every nuke on Earth will eventually cover the entire planet. Within the first 15 minutes of all nukes going off, hundreds of millions of people will be dead. Billions more are exposed to radiation and will become sick in the near future. Everyone else will struggle to survive, but in the end, they will suffer the same fate – death by nuclear winter. 30 minutes after all nukes on Earth explode. The radiation that's spreading across the planet begins to seep into plants and animals. In the days to come, almost nothing will be safe to eat. The sky continues to darken as more and more smoke from uncontrolled fires burns across the planet. The debris that's been kicked up into the atmosphere from nuclear detonations will circulate in the atmosphere. In the hours and weeks to come, day will soon turn to night as the sun's rays are blocked. 60 minutes after all nukes on Earth explode. People who were unlucky enough to be looking toward the blasts when the nuclear bombs went off begin to regain some of their vision. Things appear hazy at first, tinted in white, as if looking at the world that's being illuminated by harsh fluorescent light. If they were in a state of shock as they looked upon the explosion and did not look away for several seconds, their eyesight will take much longer to recover and may never return at all. The temperature of the planet continues to increase, but it will eventually plateau and then begin to cool. It's estimated that even if just 100 nuclear bombs explode on Earth, they will kick up enough debris into the atmosphere to cause a small nuclear winter. But in this scenario, 130 times more nukes than that have just been detonated. It's only a matter of time before the sun's warmth is blocked and radioactive snow begins to fall across the planet. 12 hours after all nukes on Earth explode. There are two groups of people who survive the initial blast. The first group happened to be close enough to the explosion that they received a huge dose of radiation and burns all over their body, but not close enough to be incinerated. They're not doing so well as their internal organs are beginning to shut down, and the number of mutated cells is growing uncontrollably within their bodies. Their skin has turned a fiery red color as they're being cooked from the inside out. They struggle to make it further away from the blast sites and seek help, but there is no help to be had. Everyone else is fleeing as well. People who were exposed to this much radiation will likely not make it through the first 24 hours after all the nuclear bombs on Earth go off. The second group of people, which makes up pretty much everyone else who's still alive, were far enough away from the nuclear explosions that they only received a small dose of initial radiation or no radiation at all. This will change in the coming days as the entire planet is coated in radiation, but as of right now, these groups of people are hunkering down and waiting for information on what to do next that will never come. Eventually, they will figure out that they're all alone and they need to fend for themselves. They'll seek out basic necessities like food and water. Unfortunately, it's these things that will eventually kill them. One day after all nukes on Earth explode, the sky continues to darken. People continue to get sicker and sicker from the radiation in the air they breathe and the water they're putting into their bodies. More and more people die. Fires continue to rage across the planet. The Earth is slowly turning into a dark ball of death. 5 days after all nukes on Earth explode, the sun and the stars can no longer be seen in the sky. Ash, smoke, and dust from the nuclear blasts and burning debris have engulfed the entire planet as they're carried on the newly formed wind currents. The amount of energy and heat put into the atmosphere from the nuclear blasts has altered climates and weather patterns across the globe. Rain patterns shift, flooding areas that get little rain with gallons of toxic precipitation. Other parts of the world will be plunged into an endless drought that will eventually change entire regions into lifeless deserts. Entire ecosystems begin to die, as their main source of energy, the sun, can no longer reach them. Plants cannot carry out photosynthesis without sunlight. Therefore, carbon dioxide levels skyrocket in the atmosphere, as it becomes harder and harder for humans and other animal survivors on Earth to breathe. There are likely not many people left 5 days after the initial blasts, as billions have succumbed to radiation, fires, disputes with other humans, or just given up. For those who still remain, they are witnessing the beginnings of a nuclear winter. But beyond the smoke-filled layer of the atmosphere, something even more terrifying is happening. When the bombs first detonated, they caused the atmosphere to become superheated, which produced nitrogen oxides. Now the sunlight that's bounced back into space from the smoke and the dust in our atmosphere is creating more nitrogen oxides. The problem with nitrogen oxide is that it destroys ozone. This means years from now, when the smoke finally clears, harmful UV rays from the sun will bombard the surface of the Earth. This could cause a drastic rise in temperature and harmful mutations to occur in anything that was initially resilient enough to survive the nuclear doomsday. There likely won't be much life left at that point, but some incredibly resilient lichen and fungi may still survive, and there will be pockets of bacteria across the planet, but pretty much all plants and animals on the surface of the Earth will have perished. Surprisingly, extremophiles that thrive near hydrothermal vents may be unaffected in the days and years after all the nukes on Earth have exploded. The waters in the oceans will absorb radiation, but creatures that deep may not receive lethal doses or might be able to tolerate it. These incredible organisms will probably just carry on business as usual, even if all life on the surface has been wiped out, 1 month after all nukes on Earth explode. Nuclear winter has begun. The temperature of the planet has dropped drastically as no sunlight has reached the surface in weeks. A mix of snow and soot from the still-burning fires fall from the sky. It's not a clean white snow, but instead contains dirty flakes with the charred remains of what used to be buildings, plants, and animals. The population of humans on Earth has reached extinction levels. There may still be a few survivors, and some astronauts on board the International Space Station might still be alive as they watch in horror as the planet that was once their home is consumed by darkness. But even these last few humans will eventually succumb to the perils of a post-apocalyptic world. 6 months after all nukes on Earth explode, trees have lost all of their leaves. Hardy plants like evergreens try to carry on, but even they die from lack of sunlight and contaminated water. Deep in the Arctic, lichens and grasses have held on, but like everything else, they begin to die off as well. Some of these organisms will be trapped in the growing ice and permafrost spreading across the planet. After the nuclear winter is over, those areas will begin to melt, and the preserved seeds could grow once again. Now that there are no longer plants, any remaining animals who once relied on them will also perish. 6 months after the nuclear bombs went off, the megafauna on the planet, like wolves, deer, elephants, lions, etc., will likely be all dead from radiation in the air or food that they're eating. If they aren't already dead, they would be very sick. Some might have developed mutations in their cells that have driven them to become monsters. Predators will now eat absolutely anything they can sink their teeth into. Bears with singed and matted fur scavenge the bodies of long dead animals. Tigers, covered in decaying flesh and vicious temperaments, stalk already sick and weakened prey. These animals are solely driven by pain and hunger. They will do anything to survive, even if it means killing and eating their own kind. The world has become the stuff of nightmares. At that same time, any human that remains on the surface of the planet is oozing blood and pus out of radiation burns on their skin. Maybe they'd been surviving deep in a cave system that protected them from much of the radiation, but eventually they needed to come out and find resources. At that point, the radiation would consume them just like every other living thing on the planet. They would become very ill, very quickly. Doomsday preppers and the super rich who have reserved their spots in doomsday shelters and bunkers may still be alive. There are some pretty ingenious setups that would allow humans to survive underground for years at a time. However, this would only be possible if those people were somehow not caught in the initial blasts. Someone would need to be very close to their shelter at the time of a detonation in order to escape the carnage unfolding. Perhaps these people will be the future of the human species. It'll be a sad day when they reemerge from their bunkers only to find a decimated, lifeless planet. 5 years after all nukes on Earth explode. Any humans lucky enough to survive in doomsday shelters that are located miles away from any blast sites will be able to step outside. Radiation levels have now gone down. There will still be higher than normal levels of radiation, but it will likely not be at lethal levels. However, after 5 years of intense cooling from nuclear winter, the entire planet has become a frozen wasteland. Ice sheets and glaciers extend out from the poles, reaching deep into the oceans. Since sunlight hasn't reached the planet's surface in years, even the equatorial regions of the Earth are now frozen. After 5 years of nuclear winter, the debris in the atmosphere finally begins to settle. Sunlight breaks through and temperatures begin to stabilize. Natural processes cause the planet to reach a new equilibrium. This is the thing about our planet, it's incredibly resilient. If all the nukes in the world detonated at once, the destruction would be immense, and it would wipe out most of the life on Earth while simultaneously altering the planet's temperature and weather patterns. However, given enough time, the radiation and debris in the atmosphere would dissipate, and the climate would return to its normal cycles. Life would find a way to continue on, and eventually plants and animals would repopulate the planet. Humans probably wouldn't make it, and if they did, the number of individuals would be so low that the gene pool would likely become riddled with genetic diseases and mutations. So there's a good chance that even if humans could last underground for the years that the nuclear winter persists on the surface, in the decades that follow their reemergence, the species would go extinct due to lack of resources and low genetic diversity. If all the nukes on Earth exploded at the same time, there would be flashes of light, immediate destruction, and long-term climate change. Most of the life on Earth would probably not make it through the years of nuclear winter, but new life would emerge to inhabit the brave new world that would come out of the disaster. We can only hope that whatever species evolves after the fallout from all the nuclear bombs subsides are smarter than us humans were. There's really no reason we should have over 13,000 nukes on our planet. A few nukes are enough to deter an enemy. Dozens of nukes can wipe out a country. Hundreds of nukes could claim the lives of millions and alter the climate of the planet. Thousands of nukes could wipe out life across continents. So it's clear that this incredibly scary what-if scenario could get out of hand very, very quickly if we're not careful. Now watch What If the Earth Stopped Spinning, minute by minute, or check out What If Japan Was Never Hit by Nuclear Bombs.